We have people from the industry who have gone through it. We have people from the banking and financials. So, Mr. Modi, I would like to start with you because you play multiple roles. You have built your own organizations, right? You have been part of the industry associations, helping and kind of guiding all the other organizations around to scale up, and also participating a lot with the government to kind of create a framework and regulatory environment and policies and whatnot. So let's see let's make a start with you and see what you have to say about it.
Let us start. You know, this is what we have gathered here to understand that how small and medium industries can prosper. This is the basic idea of probably today's tone. Now let us see, when we got independence in 47, India had a very infant stage in manufacturing. There was none. In fact, we could not make even a pin. So from that level, we have now come where manufacturing has taken a shape. But there is a disadvantage here. We have a large population, and whatever is made, and this is how our so-called big industrialists have grown on Parmit Raj and this. So quality was not an issue at all in this formative stage of, you know, independence or 50, 60 years. And whatever was made, manufactured, was sold. There was no need for quality. But as the globalization is taking place and the information is so quick that you understand what is happening in the market on day-to-day basis, and as the income is growing, the consumers are opting for a better product. And this must be going in Prime Minister's mind, that unless he comes out with the idea where we talk about quality, when we talk about make in India, this is needed, and this is how this idea was coined, this is how I feel the Prime Minister was talking about.
You have gone through building Robo, Silicon and a couple of other organizations, right? And you've been doing it since 1990, if I'm not wrong. Now, I see the regulatory environment far more easier for the world today, or at least getting easier, right? In the time when you started, what were the points where you felt a kind of roadblock and thought that this is the time that, no, I either have to give up or do something drastically different to grow? So any thoughts on that?
See, when we have started this RoboSilicon to manufacture sand from granite, which is a superior substitute for river sand. River sand is very scarce, everybody knows, and which is causing environmental damage throughout the country because of the indiscriminate quarrying of river sand. Because the rivers have not grown for the last 100 years. Same rivers or some rivers have grown dry as well. And the construction activity has grown multi-million fold, where the demand is so high and we are extracting from the same river source. So as a substitute, we brought this concept of manufactured sand for the first time in a commercial way. So what we did differently was we try to sell to the customers the quality, quantity, and the service. Sure. So we were offering, for the first time, we have gone from volume-based to weight-based mechanism. So where the weight is constant, weight is accurate, and there cannot be any deviation.
So you were the first one who actually switched
to weight-based.
So you kind of innovated the way the yes. things change.
And the customer also can check okay. the weight. So where the volume, it is all subjective. Volume, you can manage the volume by redoing the sand in the truck.
Sure.
So like that. So that was the first step which we earned good appreciation from the customers as well.
Sure.
And the service you get on this day, you get it on this day.
Sure.
And you don't have to worry about whether you have a slab tomorrow. So you worry about
very very interesting thought. So yeah. I would like to come to you, Mr. Prakash. How does kind of textile industry play a role in terms of innovating themselves to grow from one mark to the other mark? I see that textile industry is that represent India is not just playing a prominent role in the country, but also with lot of players across the world, right? So I know that we manufacture stuff for a lot of retail chains and big brands outside the country. So where is it that all this is coming from, and how is that textile industry in India is growing from that small mark to the larger and further large?
Today, textile has there is a technical textiles where in West Germany, in the conference they have segregated the textiles into 10 segments, differently: octotech, technical tech, plus a furniture tech, automobile tech. There are very big scope in textiles. Unfortunately, we are just beginning in India. There's a lot of potential for this technical textile in India. All this we are getting imported, not manufactured in India. So in these 10 segments, hardly fabric and furniture in India we make. Remaining 8, most of them we make in India or we just get imported. But in fabrics, definitely we are number one in India. For technical textiles, I think that the government should do three things. This, for composite mill, we need a big land acquisition. That is a problem. Second, ease of doing business. That is again a major issue. Third, labor laws. If these three things government consider and do in a good way, as such, the labor laws have come, they have brought it into 4 categories. And the government is intending to do, but this should be doing in a very rapid speed way so that the technical textile, the investment per composite mills, the investment is large. So without FDI participation, it is difficult for Indian people to start. With this, there is a lot of scope for SMEs. There are 3 issues, major issues the government should do. Land acquisition for industries, it should be mere. For instance, if you see in Telangana, there are many projects that are stuck up because of land acquisition. They are in court. It is in the court. It takes years of a couple of years. That should be shortlisted to within the months, and then it should be result oriented. Second thing, you see, being a country, we are standing at 140 ease of doing business. In international, we stay 140 at ease of doing business. For every business to start, there are so many, we have got to so many departments for license. From pillars to posts, we have to go. And it takes a couple of months. And third, labor loss. If these 3 and things from the government side, if they go into the rapid speed and support the SMEs, it will be good. On the other side of the SMEs, I say, as it is a world of competitiveness, there should be rapid technology upgradation regularly as per the requirement. Still in some industries they go in their routine manner, but in a competitive manner, if you want to competitive in India and abroad, it is difficult. And the other thing I suggest from the government, they should, from the other countries, they should enter into bilateral agreement so that, and help the traders for SMEs to export, and then they set up their own institute to guide the SMEs. Because one of the major problem with SMEs is R&D. Because R&D takes most of the, it's a very huge investment. If the government supports to SMEs with R&D, definitely I think this will, 100 mark growth will be there.
Awesome. So that's an interesting point you brought about FDI investment that goes into R&D. And we have Mr. Sampath Kumar. Sampath ji, though we are talking about the FDIs and we are talking about the lack of the financial support in terms of R&D, But I feel probably as a gentleman from SIDBI, you probably would be smiling and thinking, no, we already have all those things, right? So what do you have to say about it?
No, what exactly is happening in India is that India has become the fastest growing economy in the world. We have pushed the Chinese economy into the second spot. Chinese economy is under strain now. Now, how this has happened over a period of time, like for the past 20 years, a lot of effort has been put in by all the stakeholders. It's right from government of India, state governments, the financial institutions, banks, and so on, entrepreneurs, and so on. So the investment climate is ideal in our country. That means that there is a stable government, the resources are substantial here, we have a huge youth population here, and by 2020, we are going to become the youngest populated country in the world. So that's the biggest edge that we are having compared to others. So the FDIs, FIIs, what they are looking in for is that, if, well, look, when I invest here, where there is a stable government, what's the return that I get compared to the other investments in other countries, actually? So that's the thing. So towards this only, this Brand India concept had come here. And there's one more concept that's becoming very popular, that is supply chain finance mechanism, wherein, I'll just give a small example. A company headquartered in Toronto, it's a real example, actually. A company headquartered in Toronto, they are just having one head office there, but they want to manufacture a product. They are not manufacturing in Canada. Their R&D team is sitting in USA, New Jersey, USA. Then they are taking the resources from Malaysia. They are taking the Chinese labor, actually, because it's very cheap, actually. Then they are taking the after-sale service from Thailand. So this is a supply chain, actually, wherein all the MSMEs which are there in these countries, they are contributing to this. They are taking the advantage of each and every aspect of what's the strength in a country, actually. So here only, our SMEs should compete. If you want to be global, if you want to compete globally, you have to compete in terms of the quality, in terms of the market, in terms of the service. So the supply chain mechanism is one of the very good avenues that's available for MSMEs. In fact, a lot of FDIs and FIIs who are coming here for investing here, they are looking in for this, actually.
I think that's a perfect example, I would say, of the way the world is moving today, right?